here today with Gabby Luma from Tucson, Arizona, CEO of Mod Ventures. Mod Ventures is a joint venture with Beach Fleischman, a large established firm in Arizona. And Gabby, always a pioneer in this business in terms of CPA firm business model and in the use of technology, is bringing some of her DNA to that big firm of 25, 26 partners. And we're going to hear today from Gabby on what's going on in the business, what's going on with tax season, and what the future holds for CPA firms and the clients of CPA firms. When did you know that the COVID crisis was real? How did it impact your firm and when?
Well, you know, we're in Arizona, so, and we do have clients throughout the United States. So, you know, to say that we're just impacted by the Arizona world is a little bit different than, you know, we truly are affected by the whole world. So we have clients in New York that, you know, things changed for them rather quickly. And when they started changing, we started realizing, oh my goodness, we're going to have to really buckle down. In Arizona, we started seeing shutdowns mid-March. And, you know, that's when the governor came out and really set up the who are essential businesses and such. And then the cities and towns started shutting down businesses. And that's when things really got real for us. Because then we started seeing that, you know, our businesses that we work with on a regular basis, and, you know, we're outsourced accounting. So we work with clients on a regular basis, like weekly. And when we started seeing that things were gonna be shut down, we knew that potentially we could be in trouble. So we started working really hard on kind of transitioning and seeing what we needed to do to help our clients quickly.
When things got real,
yeah.
What did you have to do? What adjustments did you have to make?
Well, really early on, we started talking about, you know, our business owners were going to be needing to make adjustments to payments that they were going to make to vendors. We were going to have to start sending out letters asking for extensions. So we came up with a template right away. And we started putting out as much information as we could through marketing and our newsletters and directly to clients what we knew as things were unfolding. So our communication just like quadrupled. We had to put out information as quickly as we possibly could and let people know, you know, there's hope. You know, we're going to be seeing some loans coming out. The disaster loans are coming out. Some people were really, really in a panic. And so we had to let people know that there was hope. You know, let's keep a level head. Let's keep moving forward. Let's start creating some plans for the future. And hopefully calm the storm that they were starting to feel. And I would say this started happening probably, you know, beginning of April, because for sure after, you know, a week of no business coming in, it's a whole new world.
What do you call this new mode? It's not tax season mode. It's not extension season mode. Is it PPP season mode? Is it COVID relief season mode? Is it just a season, or is it something that will continue for a while?
You know, I don't know how to define it exactly. I think it's a time for us to be in advisory mode, and maybe it's advisory season, you know? Maybe that's what's happening, is it's time for us to really pull our pants up and, you know, get our hands dirty, deep into where each and every client is and see how we can help them survive. So, new mode.
New mode. But the new advisory season mode.
Yeah.
Which clients or which kinds of clients are the most negatively impacted by this?
Our gyms have been the worst. So the gym owners have been absolutely the worst. I think it's been really hard for them to pivot in the fact that they have this commercial building full of equipment that they are needing to either pay for or keep going, because that's how they get paid, right? It's membership based. And when people can't come in and use equipment or use those services, then immediately they're impacted by membership loss. And so I think that was probably one of the first clients that we saw that was dramatically impacted. Now we have restaurants that have changed up, you know, how they do business, and they're pivoting to delivery or, you know, curbside delivery, those sorts of things. But the gyms have been the worst, I think, out of most of our clients. Next, I would say probably the doctors who did more like the elective type of work. Dentists, very, very difficult for them because their business stopped overnight as well. And so we're seeing a lot of health and wellness types of clients in our work that just have not been able to really pivot. There's really no way to go, you know, nowhere to go.
Gabby, do you have an idea of how long these conditions might continue?
People are scared. And so I don't think it matters what state you're in. You know, there's going to be some people who are going to go out and do business as usual. Then there's going to be, you know, a third that will be waiting just a little while. And then there's going to be a whole nother third. They're going to be like, we're not going out until August or September. So, it's going to be a slow progression. And I think we're seeing a lot of things across the news where restaurants are saying, I can't open just partially. You know, there's no way I can make a living. So those shutdowns may last for longer. So it really probably just depends on the industry and it depends on the state you're in.
How much damage will COVID have caused by the time we get on the other side of this, whenever that is?
It really has been minimized by the need of new service. And so what we've, let's say, lost or maybe discontinued for a brief period of time, we're gaining back in new business. And so although, you know, a lot of firms may be completely losing clients, we're gaining clients, I would say predominantly because of our business model and what we do for those businesses, with outsourced accounting services. It's like another disaster measure that they can take to outsource their accounting and have it in the cloud, which they didn't have before. So I see this as, and I mean, I hate to be so optimistic, but this is an opportunity for us and for CPAs across the nation, you know, to really move their practice into a virtual type of format. I call them our big brother for Beach Fleischman. You know, they had to go virtual very quickly and have their remote workforce. And so, you know, very quickly they had to move into that direction. We were very fortunate in that we were already there. And so the damage of not being able to move quickly, they're not going to have that same problem because they moved quickly. But, you know, other firms who are unable to move quickly, who are not set up the way that we are, will have a lot more challenges in the future, let's say.
Some people have told me that the things that they were planning to do for 5 or 6 years and were insisting couldn't be done, they figured out a way to do it in 5 or 6 days. And so a lot of firms have gone virtual, gone remote, figured this out in a hurry and are still working out some of the wrinkles. Sure. You were there first, you were there early, you were prepared. What kind of new business services and what kind of new business are you bringing in these days?
We've had a lot of people who have just, you know, really started paying attention to their finances. And so I'm going to say that we've had clients that have been waiting to come to us. You know, they're aware that we're around and they now feel like they need to pull the trigger. So I think that, you know, the awareness that we've already created in the community and what we do, the urgency is just increased. So that's a big part of what's happened. I don't know that we're doing a whole lot of different things. I mean, PPP obviously is a whole nother nut to crack, but we provide the information. We've helped people through that process. And it just seems like something that we do on a regular day basis anyway. You know, we have the information already done. It's already provided there. So we made a decision early on that we weren't not going to, you know, be hooking up banks to actually, you know, with the clients. Clients had to find their own banking relationship and work with them. But we would provide that information. So it's nothing different than what we would normally do. So really, it's just digging in deeper to what we currently do and providing those services to people who are now ready to say yes to the service line we already have.
How well are they working?
Oh, that's a really good question. So I'm seeing across the board that the smaller community banks are doing a better job. And we're hearing that from everywhere. The whole profession is saying so. My friends that are working with other clients, you know, in their areas are saying the same things. So I think the small businesses that are working with the community banks are doing better. I think the small businesses that kind of got stuck with the larger banks, the Chases, obviously Wells Fargo, who couldn't even really help very many of their clients, you know, kind of gotten stuck. So we don't have a lot that actually qualified for the PPP loan forgiveness. We're gathering information now to see how many, but I want to say it's probably a handful, no more than 10. And out of a book of business, let's say, of a total of 500 clients, various ways, 10, it's not very good. So in many ways, I'm happy that we're starting to get business back to, you know, going, because there's no help coming for a lot of the small businesses. There's just none.
That sounds scary.
It is. Yeah.
What's going to happen with those small businesses with no help coming?
Well, I think a lot of them are going to have to go into restartup mode. You know, it's a whole new world, and they're going to have to rethink of their business back when it was, let's say, 2 to 3 years old. They're going to have to be really good at marketing. Really good at marketing and bringing in their local people to help support them. You know, in the Tucson area, we have a big local market where people want you to shop local, and they support each other. They post each other's, you know, advertisements on Instagram and Facebook, and there's groups. So we have a really strong market in the Tucson area for shop local. And I think that you're going to have to make friends with a lot of these local businesses so that they support you, and make friends with the people, your clients, your customers, so that they support you as well, you know, so that you can keep around, because it's word of mouth, word of mouth, word of mouth. And that's the best way these small businesses, I think, are going to stay alive.
That sounds like a difficult situation. It sounds like the American economy is going to look a little bit different on the other side of COVID.
Yeah. Well, and I mean, again, I want to be optimistic. I really do. I want to be optimistic, but you know, I really don't think we're going to have the roaring 2020 that we were hoping to have. I think it's going to be the roaring 2021. I think there is a lot of pent-up demand. I think there are people who want to buy, but people are going to be putting off making those buying decisions because of the uncertainty. So because of uncertainty, people will hold on to their money. And so I think it will be a time where there will be a lull, you know, and we're saying, what, 30 million people that are unemployed? It's going to take time to get all those people back into the workplace safely. And for all the different safety measures to be taken and implemented properly.
How many accounting firms won't make it?
So I think the accounting profession is a really interesting profession. You have large firms, you know, you have like the top 50, and they're the ones that are going to be, you know, top 100, top 200. They're the ones that are going to be really able to weather the storm probably a lot easier than a smaller practitioner. If you're a small practitioner and you're older and you're getting up into your retirement years, you know, you're going to have to make a decision. And I think this has been the same decision that you've had to make probably for the last 10 years. Do you want to learn more, or do you want to retire? Or do you want to sell? And can you sell? And so it's the same decision. It's just, do you have anything to sell now? And I think that's where, you know, the smaller professionals are going to have a hard time, because, and I really think it's not just the CPA profession. I think, you know, any profession, like a dentist practice or orthodontist practice, we're all bumping up to this same succession problem. But the CPA profession in particular, technology has been just like this head-butting experience. And if you don't want to learn it, and you don't want to invest in people learning it in your firm, you will not survive this. It's not possible. I don't think you can survive it.
So for many firms, they're going to have to recommit to a new kind of capital investment, whether it's intellectual capital or hardware capital in terms of technology, or the learning capital and getting everybody up the learning curve, or the marketing capital to reposition and remarket your firm. There are many firms that don't run with a lot of capital reserves. They run ATMs.
Right.
And for those firms who have to make a pivot, it's a bad time to try to make a pivot.
Yeah. Well, yeah, because you're losing clients because they no longer can afford you or they're no longer in business. You need to invest in technology. You need to invest the time. And that does take time, you know. As you mentioned before, you know, it takes like, you know, a decision you were going to make for 5 years out, you can make in 5 days, and it's literally that quick. You know, some of the decisions we made to switch to certain platforms really didn't take that long once we just saw the need. It's getting the, you have to really want it. And if you're, you know, 2 or 3 years out from retirement, do you really want it? And I think that's the bottom line, is you're going to have to really want to make those changes. The technology cost has really come down. So it's not quite so much the technology cost. It's more so the intellectual capital that you're going to have to, and time you're going to have to spend diving deep. Because if you have no one else in your firm to do it, it's you. So are you going to take this time, this lull, and use it to learn something new? And businesses, people, CPAs that are seeing that this is a lull in time, which a lot of people are seeing this as an opportunity to learn something new. It's perfect time. You know, so I think it's, I'm doing that. I'm, you know, even though we're ahead, I want to see what the next thing is. And so I'm spending time investing, you know, an 8 hour day each week to see what else we could be doing to improve.
Now, that's interesting. You're spending an 8 hour day each week mm-hmm. investing in seeing what you can improve. Mm-hmm. What's that 8 hour day look like? What do you do during that 8 hour day?
Well, there's so many different things that are starting to come out, like training. And I've never been a person that just goes to CPA training only, you know? So I would go out of my own profession. And so last week there was a class with the storytelling brand, I think it is. And he had a whole day on how do you build a story? How do you write a book? How do you write an Instagram post? You know, it was all day and it was $99 investment, really inexpensive. And you learn from the best of the best and how do you build a story. So that's what my 8 hours look like last week. This week, and they happen to be on Tuesday each week. So this week was a online conference that had to go online that we would not have had the opportunity to do. It's called the Accounting Salon. And I sat through, you know, 9 hours of CPE webinar and learned from people who are doing some really amazing things. And I didn't even know about it, but it was just by talking to another colleague in the business that I found out about it. So, you know, I'm searching out ways to improve my knowledge and surround myself around different people. So it's been really cool to, you know, sit down and say, I'm going to spend 8 hours, or I'm going to take a system and break it down, you know, and build out a new process over 8 hours. But I'm using this time to build a better firm.
When this is all over, what will accounting firms look like, particularly smaller accounting firms?
I believe smaller firms are going to come out of this and realize that they are more than the tax return. That's my hope. Their advisors, they know so much more and they can help so much more. And they're going to realize that it's so valuable that they learn to charge for it too.
Yeah, I hope you're right. I hope you're right. What's next for the firms that are already virtual?
I think the next for the virtual firms are to really define their service lines, get really, really serious about it, about what they're going to be providing to their clients as they're evolving their business during this time. Getting super tight around process and systems and building a firm that if you're not there, we'll run without you. I think a lot of the virtual firms that we have, I mean, even the smaller practitioners, they're predominantly the person, the knowledge bringer of that business. And they will need to start thinking about how they're going to disseminate their knowledge to the rest of the team so that they're not that predominant knowledge keeper. I think that's a great next step for these technology virtual type firms like mine. You're really building the knowledge base.
Gabby, what I get out of this is that the firms that survive and thrive out of this catastrophic period will be the ones that have learned how to get smart fast, mm-hmm. transition from compliance to advisory, and how to communicate and over communicate who they are and what they can do for clients.
Yeah, I agree with that completely.
Thank you very much.